What's up, guys? Welcome to church this Sunday.
Come on, my name's Harmon.
My name's Brendan.
And we are your MCs for today. You are officially in the pre-show.
Show!
Come on, woo! And we got some awesome news for you.
Yeah,
why don't you tell them, first off, what we got going for them?
First off, we have a drive-in service coming up at Weka on the 28th.
Yes, 28th of June. Mark your calendars, all right? We are going to be driving in for live church.
Come on, in-person church.
I know, I've been waiting for this,
this is crazy.
Such a long time. It's going to be super exciting. We did one out in Spruce Grove, which was amazing.
So good.
And people loved it. And so we're bringing it to Edmonton. Come
now
on.
We are.
And it's going to be good. And so you can sign up for that how, Brendan?
You got to go to scatteredsaints.ca to pre-register for that.
Yes. Yeah, you got to sign up for the Eventbrite. But also, not just the service. We've got something more. We got more. We
what?
Always got more here at the pre-show.
There's more?
There's more. We got a movie happening on the same day, a little later after the service. And you can also sign up for that at
scatteredsaints.ca.
Come on. For everything you need, it's just a simple place. One,
wow.
One location, scatteredsaints.ca.
So convenient.
So make sure you go check that out. Also, at the end of the service today, we've got an after party for you.
Woo.
Where you can connect with people. You know, it's sunny outside. People are barbecuing. Why don't you jump on Zoom, show everyone your nice barbecue. It's going to be great.
Do a little live cooking feed.
Yes, exactly. Why don't we do like live steak cooking for our next pre-show?
That'd be sick.
I can't promise that, but we're going to try.
But that would be
amazing. We'll see if it's in the budget. Anyways. All right, guys. Well, why don't you enjoy the service? We got worship coming up, so why don't you stand up, get ready to worship with us, and it's going to be a great Sunday.
Give up on me. You love is holding on. You won't let go. The feeling breaking out. right, church, it's time to get wild in your house. Come on, let's go. Put our hands together. Let's sing this out.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my turn. Till I met you.
Yeah.
I was breathing, but not alive. All my failures I've tried to hide. It was my turn.
Yeah.
Till I met you.
Come on, church, just sing us all together.
You call my name. And I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day.
To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt.
Let's sing this together.
Praise the Father.
So good to be with you, church. As we approach our giving moment today, I want to remind us of some things that happened in the scripture. I remember a story where Jesus was questioned about paying his taxes, and to do it, he actually takes some money out of the mouth of a fish. Now, if we could all pay our taxes that way, that would be amazing. But he ends with this phrase. He says, you know, you give to Caesar what is Caesar's, or the government what is theirs, and you give to God what is God's. And when we study the Bible and we go through scripture, the Bible actually talks about tithes, offerings, and alms. There are things that God, as we've given our life to Jesus and we follow him one step at a time, he asks us to invest from our wallet, our finance, our lives into his kingdom. Then there's moments and times where we have special projects where we get to feed people and do outreach ministries and things like that, that we give offerings over and above what is God's. And then there's also a thing called alms where we actually make it a part of our heart and our regular process to care for those who have deep need. So I want to encourage you today, where are you at with your giving, with your heart before God? Ask him to challenge you. I dare you to ask him to challenge you, because God wants to do some amazing things through this church, through this body of people, through his scattered saints. And the best thing we can do is open our heart and say, God, what is yours? What are you asking of me? And how can I give? If you'd like to give today, you can go to scatteredsaints.ca/give. The links are all there. God bless you as you give today.
Romans 12:15 says this, rejoice with those who rejoice, mourn with those who mourn. Today is going to be a day that might be filled with some tension, some apprehension. For some of us, I'm going to say too much. For others, I'm not going to say enough. I am trying to live in the tension. I'm trying to live in the midst of the uncomfortable. Some of you are angry and confused about that, and others are angry and confused about why you are angry and confused. I've been trying to find the words, and most of the time, I'm lost for words. So I want to stick with the words of Jesus. Why don't you grab a Bible with me? We're going to Luke chapter 10. Luke chapter 10, we're going to verse 25. One day, an expert in religious law, a lawyer, stood up to test Jesus by asking him this question. Teacher, what should I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus replied, what does the law of Moses say? How do you read it? How do you interpret it? How do you see it? What's the lens that you're looking at the world through? The man answered, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your strength, and all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Right, Jesus said. Do this and you will live. The man wanted to justify his actions. So he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Who is my neighbor? Now, because he's a lawyer, we know that he's interpreting two pieces of scripture, Deuteronomy 6 and Leviticus 19, and he's trying to come to his understanding. He already has a preconceived notion of who his neighbor is. In other words, he is trying to pick who he is going to love. Instead of answering directly, Jesus replies with a story. And it's a story that many of us may or may not be familiar with, the story of the Good Samaritan. To be honest, most of us have written this story off as a kid's story, because if you have grown up in church or if you've grown up in Christianity, then you've heard this story and you heard it on like a felt board and there's all these like actions and we're like, okay, that's what the story's like. Or you've watched it on a VeggieTales cartoon and you've seen it and you've written it off. Now, what you didn't know is that this story is actually a common story. It was a common story of this era, and it was a fable. And it was a fable that was used, and it had two most popular iterations. Both of them featured the prominent character as a rabbi. The first iteration was a rabbi who reached out and he touched and he was able to cleanse a leper. The other was a rabbi and he found a shipwrecked Roman soldier. And he helped that Roman soldier. The point or the purpose of this fable or this tale, this very common story, was to extol the virtues of the rabbi. So Jesus takes the common story, the common thread, the common narrative, and he flips the story and he begins to tell this story, the story of the Good Samaritan, where a man who is on his way, you know, to a dangerous place, so let's just call it Calgary, and he's on his way down the road and he gets jumped by some muggers. He gets beaten, he gets left broken and for dead. All his possessions gone. He's literally half naked, bleeding out. The severity of his injuries would put him in what we would define as critical condition. First comes a priest. The priest sees the man, crosses the road, keeps walking. The next person comes along, a Levite, temple assistant. You know, in our language or vernacular, because Levites were the group of people that, especially in the Old Testament, led in worship. So the Levites, or the worship leader, sees him, crosses the road, and keeps walking. A man beaten, bloodied, fighting for his life on the side of the road. Just a guy trying to go to work. Just a guy trying to make his delivery. Just a guy trying to drop off his goods, beaten and broken. Just a guy trying to feed his family. And the most virtuous of society at this time, the priest and the worship leader, you know, the people that we hold up on a pedestal. So we could say someone like me, a pastor, a preacher, and a worship leader, see the brokenness, see the hurt, see the violence, and cross the street and keep walking. But it's a Samaritan. We know him as the Good Samaritan, who sees him, picks him up, puts him on his animal, takes him, pays for his medical and lodging expenses, and we move on from the story. But we don't often talk about the ones who looked away. Bishop Jakes, T.D. Jakes, says this: the church has a tendency to look away. Anything that gets ugly, that we don't want to deal with, we look away. We might say, oh, the Samaritans, they just didn't like each other. No, no, we're talking about hundreds of years of racial tension between these people. Samaritans were viewed by Jews as filthy, as animals. They didn't even want to walk through their towns, their cities, or their regions. Their maps would carve out routes. If you're using GPS and you're supposed to drive through that neighborhood, the GPS would go, recalculating, and take you on a whole new route, because you can't go there. You can't go to that neighborhood. You can't go to that area. Do you know how filthy and disgusting those people are? It was that person, those people. He was the one who stooped down to care for that man. So as a church, we have a looking away problem. We have a cross the street, walk a little faster problem. I'm in the midst currently of dealing with a personal loss. We lost my grandpa this week. And so I've been thinking about that, reflecting on that. And I think about some of the conversations that we had, the conversations that you have with your grandparents. You know, it's kind of those like, hey, where were you when kind of conversations. That took me down a rabbit trail, and it got me thinking about conversations that I might have with my grandkids. And obviously, I'm a long ways off for it, a very long, long ways off from it. But, hey, Grandpa, my future grandson says to me, or granddaughter, where were you when 9/11 happened? I can remember. I was happy to be in a computer lab during English writing, when all of our computers had a message pop up and our teacher gathered us around a TV and we watched the towers fall. I can remember, where were you when? I started thinking about the questions that my grandkids might ask me. Hey, Grandpa, where were you when the Oilers reclaimed the Stanley Cup? It's gonna happen so many times. Where were you when? I started thinking about the questions they might ask me. Hey, Grandpa, where were you when the world was hit with the pandemic? Oh, I look back into my granddaughter's eyes and say, oh, like COVID-19? And she looks up at me and says, no, hate. Where were you when? we've been thinking and praying about in church circles for a long time, using words like awakening in prayer meetings. Yeah, I'm talking to the church today. We've used phrases like a shaking. We've prayed for these things. We've prayed for these things for years. So why are we so surprised when it's happening? Maybe because it looks and it feels different, but this is our time. This is that which we have been praying for. We get to live that right now. This is a global repositioning of the church. In no way did God inflict or cause COVID-19, but He is using it for His glory to reposition us as a church, to awaken us, to cause there to be a personal revival, something that's happening on the depths of who we are, where He removes from us our deepest instinct to rely solely on a system to lift up the name of Jesus. And He's calling us back to a table, a personal table, to a personal relationship when it's Him and it's me. And He says, listen, we're going to gather together and we're going to do those things, but don't rely on those things, because this is about you and me. It's our relationship with Jesus that actually leads us to gather with other people. It's our relationship with Jesus which leads us to be connected. It's our relationship with Jesus that causes us to love well and to love passionately and to love generously. It's because of Jesus, not the other way around. Where were you during the global repositioning of the church? I was there and I leaned in. Where were you during a global recalibration of justice? I was there and I leaned in. This is the moment when I can feel through the screen you saying to me, come on, preacher, get back in your lane. Get back in your lane. Talk about the scripture. Talk about Jesus. Talk about worship. I'm so glad you just said that. Why don't we turn together? We're going to go to Isaiah chapter 29. And I love Isaiah 29 because I love the way that this speaks so clearly. And so the Lord says, this is Isaiah 29:13. So the Lord says, these people say they are mine. They honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me, and their worship of me is nothing but man-made rules learned by rote. In other words, it's religious and it's ritualistic and it's created to satisfy our own desires. So jumping further in, asking ourselves this next question in context of the global repositioning of the church, what is worship? What does it look like? What does it feel like? How do we experience it? Is there any guidelines? Yes, Jesus Himself spoke to this in John chapter 4. John chapter 4 says, but the time is coming, indeed, it's here now, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. The Father is looking for those who will worship Him in that way. For God is spirit, so those who worship Him must worship in spirit and in truth. Now, when we consider this portion of Scripture, we can consider this conversation that Jesus is being had. Would it surprise you to know that the context of this conversation is actually at the intersection of gender equity and racial tension? Because that very conversation being had about the heart of worship, to worship in spirit and in truth, was being had by Jesus speaking to a promiscuous Samaritan woman who had failed relationship after failed relationship, who had to go to the well in the heat of the day because she couldn't handle the chatter of the local community and the people who despised her for her set of behaviors. Did you know that that conversation was so jarring because a man shouldn't be talking to a woman, particularly not a woman of that status or stature in a community, at a well? Because there'd be so many questions that the disciples, before they went to get Jesus food, or they were considering to go and make other arrangements, they literally said, "Do you want us to leave? Like, do you want us to leave you here with, like here, like with her?" And when they came back in the conversation, they're like, "You good? Like, what's happening here?" They were nervous to even have a conversation because of what the implication was, because of who he was talking to. The Bible does not happen in isolation. It's not like the Bible exists outside of the real world. No, the Bible, these words are living narratives of people who lived in real times and real timelines. There's real situations. Did you know that that verse that we opened with, "Mourn with those who mourn, rejoice with those who rejoice"? The book of Romans was written to address a racial divide within the church at Rome. The theology was just a setting for what was happening. They had to break down the walls with their minds because their hearts were so closed. Think about this in 1 Corinthians. We're here in 1 Corinthians 14. The Apostle Paul still continuing to speak, because what you, again, may not be fully aware of right now is that there is multiple expulsions of Jews from Rome, meaning they banned Jewish people from living in the city, and many of them fled to Corinth. And so Paul is writing, addressing the church at Corinth, and he's speaking into the very hearts of issues and matters. And he says this in 1 Corinthians 12. We'll start at 12. "The human body has many parts, but the many parts make up one whole body. So it is with the body of Christ. Some of us are Jews, some are Gentiles, some are slaves, some are free, but we have all been baptized into one body by one Spirit. We all share the same Spirit. Yes, the body has many different parts, not just one part. If the foot says, 'I'm not a part of the body because I'm not a hand,' that does not make it any less part of the body. Because I am not an eye, would that make it any less part of a body? No. If the whole body were an eye, how would you hear? Or if the whole body were an ear, how would you smell anything? But our bodies have many parts, and God has put each part where he wants it. How strange a body would be if it had only one part. Yes, there are many parts, but only one body. The eye can never say to the hand, 'I don't need you.' The head can't say to the feet, 'I don't need you.' In fact, some part of the body," we'll just read this in its rawness, "some parts of the body that seem weakest and least important are actually the most necessary. And the parts we regard as less honorable are those we clothe with the greatest care. So we carefully protect those parts that should not be seen, while the more honorable parts do not require this special care. So God has put the body together such that extra honor and care are given to those parts that have less dignity. This makes for harmony among the members, so that all members care for each other. If one part suffers, all the parts suffer with it. And if one part is honored, all the parts are glad. All of you together are Christ's body, and each of you is a part of it." So we talk about true worship in spirit and in truth. And we have to be honest that most Christians do pretty well with the idea of worshiping in spirit. Not all of us are as great at worshiping in truth. Or we're really good at speaking the truth, but we forget the part where the rest of the verse says, "Speak the truth in love." And in our attempt to chase down God, to meet Jesus, to find him, to encounter his presence. We say, God, I just want to be where your heart is. And if we know anything from the scripture, we know that if you want to be where God's heart is, his heart is with those who are hurting. Yep. Let's look at the book of Joel, the book of Joel. We're going to go to chapter 2. If you're still with me on the internet, just give me all those likes. You know, if you're on Church Online, you start hitting those little hearts. If you're on Facebook, give me those thumbs up. If you're listening in the radio and you're in your truck, just say, come on, preacher. If you're sitting in a room full of people, say, I'm with you. And if you're just wanting to be a comment warrior and just chat it up down there, be like, I'm with you. This is Joel chapter 2, verse 13. A text that's thousands of years old, but that's speaking to where we are right now. Tear your hearts, not just your clothes. I guess we could rephrase it as, tear your hearts, just don't post. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, abounding in faithful love, and he relents from sending disaster. Joel 2 is actually quoting Exodus 34, which is when God the Father, is introducing himself and outlining his character. His character is graciousness and compassion, slow to anger, abounding in faithful love. That's what we are to look like, gracious and compassionate people, slow to anger, abounding in faithful love. I think Brooke Frazier, songwriter, captured the words of an entire generation, at least my generation, when she says, break my heart for what breaks yours. Break my heart for what breaks yours. A few weeks ago, I shared a quote from Dr. Michael Heiser, a theologian, scholar in our generation. And I shared the quote in light or in context of COVID-19. I shared the quote trying to communicate the idea that just because we aren't in the same building, that it doesn't mean that Jesus is limited from reaching where we are. This is the quote. If we're in Christ, we don't occupy sacred space. We are sacred space. I'm going to say it again. If we're in Christ, we don't occupy sacred space. We are sacred space. That's Dr. Michael Heiser. But now think about the same quote about not occupying sacred space, about not coming to a church building, which we've deemed sacred, when really it's the people of God who gather. That's who we are. But now think about the same quote in light of the context that we are living in today. Where were you when we begin to think about it like this? If we're in Christ, we don't occupy sacred space. We are sacred space. So our brothers and sisters on the other side, their lives are sacred because it's not about us or them. This isn't a political issue. This isn't a left or right issue. This is a fix your eyes on Jesus issue and rise above and pour out his nature and his character, graciousness, mercy, compassion, to truly love. Because if one part of the body is suffering, so too am I. Let's jump to Revelation 3. You're like, that took a turn very quickly. Revelation 3. Revelation 3, verse 20. Look, I stand at the door and knock. If you hear my voice and open the door, I will come in and we will share a meal together as friends. Think about that in light of Romans 10, that anyone and everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved, meaning there is no qualifier on who gets to sit at the table with Jesus. And he simply described those who sit at his table as friends. The Apostle Paul takes it further and calls us brothers and sisters, parts of one body. Now Jesus stands at the door and knocks, and he's inviting us to sit at the table, but to also make sure that there's a place at the table for our friends. As I shared earlier, I've been living in the tension of all of these conversations, feeling a pain from almost every side and every angle. And today, I call us to not set our eyes against one another, but to set our eyes on Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, the creator of this world, who breathed life and breath into you, who formed you out of the dust of the earth, from that same dust. I'm urging us to set our eyes on Jesus and have our hearts be examined. Tear our hearts, not just our clothes. Jesus, break my heart for what breaks yours. We can't make these changes that we're facing happen with just behavior modification, where there's consequences for certain behavior. Because behavior change is just behavior modification. And if we don't deal with the heart, then we haven't dealt with anything at all. And the truth is, you and I can't change hearts. Only Jesus can change hearts. And Jesus calls us forward. He calls us as a church, as a body, as brothers and sisters to lead the way. So who are we going to be? I think I can safely declare that we will be the people who cross the road. We're not going to look the other way. And through love and action, we will redefine the question, who is my neighbor? hey, maybe you're watching today and you feel far from Jesus. You feel like your past is defining you, and you feel like even though there's something inside of you that wants to lean in, that it's holding you back. Maybe you are watching this and there's just this deep sense of sorrow that's coming over you. Maybe you're watching this and you're feeling inspired or coming alive to some degree. Maybe you agree, maybe you disagree, but this one thing is true, that Jesus Christ is the Savior of the world, that God so loved the world, not parts of the world. He didn't say God so loved Christians. He didn't say God so loved a certain people group. He said God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten son, Jesus Christ, that anyone who calls on his name can be saved and can inherit eternal life. And my friend, in the midst of times that are rapidly changing, in a world that seems to be speeding up by the minute, I can tell you that there is peace and there is calm amidst the chaos. And there is a love that is unthinkable and undefinable in human terms that is ready and available for you if only you would invite Jesus in. Now, I need to put a disclaimer on it that if you invite Jesus in, the love that's going to flow to you, it's going to start flowing through you. You will never be the same again. You might have heard a phrase, repentance or forgiveness. It simply means to turn away from how things were and to look to Jesus for how things could be. So we look at Jesus and we follow him one step at a time. If you're watching today and you say, I want to make a decision to live my life with Jesus, we're going to pray together. Why don't you repeat this prayer after me? You're also going to see, if you're watching online, there'll be little links on Facebook, a link popping up right now. In the comments, there's a link in the description. If you're watching on the radio, you can go to scatteredsaints.ca/Jesus. And if you're watching on the radio, that's a miracle. If you're watching on church online, you just hit that button right now. Come on, let's pray together. Repeat this prayer after me if you want to invite Jesus Christ into your life to be your Lord and Savior, to never live life alone again. Say this with me. Say, dear Jesus, I need you now more than ever, so I give you everything, my wins, my losses, my sins, and my successes. It's all yours. From this moment forward, I turn away from my past life, and I look to you, and I follow you one step at a time. Would you forgive me of my sin? Show me how to love like you do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Boom! There we go. All right. Oh, we're back. We're back. We're back.
Oh, hey.
Welcome back, everyone, to the post show. Man, what an awesome service.
It's so good.
Yeah, I love it. Pastor Brett speaking, man. We're so thankful that you guys were here for service. And, you know, don't forget to jump in that after party. There's going to be a QR code that pops up. And also, we'll see you back here next Sunday for Father's Day.
Oh, yeah.
Father's Day, bro. Father's Day.
You're
dude,
right.
Come on. You got to remember that. Make sure you get a gift for your father next Sunday. And we'll also see you at the drive-in on the 28th.
Yeah,
make sure
we will.
You sign up, scatteredsaints.ca. All right. We'll see you soon.